especially.
Yeah.
Where they realize that when you come to university and you learn some things,
That is just a start. Like, that's like 1% of 1% of the job. So as Kathy has said, we've long known the importance of professional learning, helping our students, our future colleagues, learn the knowledge, skills, attributes, whatever else we might want to call it. But this whole notion of professional learning in the professions is still kind of ambiguous. It's hard to put our finger on. And all of us belong to professions that also identify lifelong learning as an important professional goal. But learning in the context of a university or in a classroom environment, and then translating that learning into the real world experience of practice is something that's still pretty poorly understood. So my task is to talk with you about what that looks like from my perspective in the School of Social Work. First of all, what's social work? Any of you know social workers? Anybody married to a social worker, have kids who are social workers? Excellent. So I was talking to Jan just a few minutes before we started and swapping stories about the similarities in our professions, but I said, you know what? If I go to a cocktail party and someone says to me, so what do you do? If I said I was a teacher, they pretty much, okay, yeah, we all get that. If you say you're a social worker, people tend to start to back away, recognize that their glass is suddenly empty. So one of my first challenges as a social work educator is to help students understand social work as, number one, a license to meddle. That's really what we do. And number two is a profession that lives off the avails of human distress. Because if people weren't in trouble, they really wouldn't need to have social workers in their lives. Social work also has had a really hard time having a sense of legitimate authority over a body of knowledge. You know, we borrow some stuff from sociology. In my particular school, we seem to borrow inordinate amounts of stuff from Foucault. I actually had to buy Foucault for dummies just to be participating in a faculty meeting. And so we borrow some from psychology, we borrow some from other kinds of learning frameworks. So trying to come up with an understanding of social work as a tacit body of knowledge has been a struggle. But we do our best. So social workers do all kinds of different things in different environments. The difficulty in coming up with the definition of social work is that if I went out and wrestled up 10 different social workers and brought them in here to this room, you would get 10 different views of what social work is, because what we do is we retreat into what I call our practice box. Right? So we have a huge child welfare specialization here at UVic, and so we prepare people for child welfare practice, either child protection or some sort of child care. So they talk about working with the ministry or one of the delegated authorities in one of the First Nations communities. I happen to have been a hospital social worker, so that's my practice box. So we start to frame our practice lens and our professional learning approach according to where we're practicing, not necessarily what we're doing. So that is one of the first tensions for social work education. The other thing that I want to talk about in terms of professional learning and professional social work is that the professional social work is a regulated profession. We have ownership of title, and those mandatory registrations belong to provincial bodies. So there are provincial regulatory bodies, and all of those provincial regulatory bodies have mandatory requirements for ongoing professional development. So I'm a registered social worker, so I have to account for 30 hours of professional development myself per year. It's self-reported, so I can claim almost anything. In fact, I might in fact claim this hour. So there's both benefit and liability in that kind of an approach. And I won't. We also have to write an exam if you weren't already a registered social worker in British Columbia. If you weren't registered prior to last September, you now have to write an exam. The complicating part of all of that is the exam that comes from the American Social Work Board, and it's administered by Pearson Educational Publishing. It's an American exam. You have to write it in one of the urban centers, so we have a huge distance So if I have someone in leftover Shoe, British Columbia, who has to write the exam, they have to go to Vernon, Vancouver, Victoria. So there's still this huge urban bias. So that's another dilemma. So the regulatory bodies is one factor that guides professional social work. The educational system is another factor.
Just a quick question. The exam itself, could you just give 1 minute to tell me what the exam is?
It's a multiple guess.
That's what I was wondering.
Yeah, 300.
300.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. So that could be
spot. LA could just select and respond.
Taste of attrition, 300.
Yeah. Okay, thank you very much. That's all I wanted to know.
I did the trial test, and I was horrified. Okay. I was actually horrified at the kinds of questions they were raised. And I was horrified at what they thought the right answers were.
But it does speak to how the profession then is regulating itself through that sort of examination.
Yeah, and doing stuff because it was expedient. All of a sudden we had, the regulatory body had permission from the government to do this, but they didn't have any resources and they couldn't sort of recreate an exam, and so they just bought into the American model.
Why did they feel the need to have an exam?
Beats the hell out of me.
Okay.
I shouldn't say that. I think there's an inherent suspicion on the part of lots of practitioners that those of us who are on my side of the desk we don't know how to prepare people for practice, so we're not good enough. We fill students' heads with nonsense and notions that don't really translate into knowing how to do social work. Which is why I have my capstone course, right? Which is what I want to talk about. But before we go there, I want to talk about the other dilemma, and I don't know if it's true for education as well, but talking about the regulatory body and the employers, because to work in most sectors in British Columbia, you have to be a registered social worker, so you have to be duly approved by the regulatory body, is that employers also expect students to have a certain skill set, knowledge acquisition. So one of the things that I'm trying to figure out is what's the difference between creating a climate where students will be responsible for their own individual learning and how I'm going to take up this thing called social work, and what is it that my practice boss expects of me? So individual learning versus what I'm calling organizational learning. So what is the difference? Who sets the professional learning agenda? And in a performative working context, power resides within the employer to determine what's valued, rewarded, and considered justifiable to learn. And one of the examples that I gave in my brief conversation is Minister Cadeau is not particularly receptive to individual social work practitioners in her child protection unit asking very complicated and curious questions about why we're doing things the way that we're doing. Even though you as an individual learning says there's got to be a better way of doing a home study, there's not a great climate for that level of curiosity and respect. So the second dilemma, and one that's much more germane to how I spend my days, is how, where, can you learn social work in a classroom, from whom, and how do you know that you're learning? So how do students know that they're actually learning to do this really perplexing thing called social work? We talk about reflective practices, all of you do, a slippery concept, really hard to identify, critical reflection and action, all those words from Schoen, but learning doesn't happen in a vacuum. And for social work practices, that kind of social and cultural context really shapes the way people take up this notion of being curious about their own practice. Social work is a complex, fragmented, and shifting world in any sector. And trying to then apply a static, unexamined, and unintegrated body of knowledge to that uncertainty is not likely to meet with any great success. To me, it would be very much like teaching a classroom of 40 kids today versus teaching a classroom of 40 kids 10 years ago, 20 years ago, 30 years ago. So how do you prepare your teachers, who are also a different breed of cat, right? The people who are coming to university and coming into professional programs are very different than they were when we all started, and the nature of the classroom So in many ways, social work is exactly like that. But for me, learning is about letting go of fond and long-held beliefs. It's personal, potentially threatening, and deeply unsettling. It's a process of deconstructing and reconstructing, at least it is for social work students. Most of my recent work has been with our graduate program. So we have a two-year and a one-year MSW program. Students come to our program from all over the country. The first year is offered here on campus. The second year is offered through course spaces through our distance management system. And the exit activity for a graduate student here at UVic is either a thesis or a practicum and a capstone course. The reason for that is the accreditation, it's a nationally accredited program, and you have to do either a thesis or a practicum. And here at UVic, all graduate programs need to have some sort of a capstone element. It used to be that graduate students had to do a piece of original research. So until 2013, our MSW students who did the practicum option had to do a research project as part of their practicum. And they either did a mini thesis, or they did something that was less than fulsome, shall we say. And they got stuck. And so when the opportunity came to redevelop our MSW program to have a practicum and a capstone course, I jumped on this and developed a capstone course. And for me, this is where I try and plant the seed of being curious about your own practice. And we use the electronic portfolio as one of the principal assignments of the capstone course. And I'm hoping that what we're doing is allowing students to develop an awareness of their own responsibility to continually examine all parts of their practice. So like teachers, as a social worker, all I've got is me. Right? I am the only tool there is. And so who I am as a person is intricately woven into who I am as a practitioner. Even though I may be required by my employer to be a technocrat or merely a functionary, a company man or woman, as it was, carrying the policy of the day. So in the capstone course, what I try and do is plant the seeds of inquiry, investigate, ask questions, grapple with this notion of ambiguity, and cultivate what I'm calling habits of mind, to be curious, to never lose that curiosity. When I teach our first-year students who are starting to think about social work as a career, I give them a little test, and I'll give the same test to you. Imagine the last time you're at the airport, and you're standing there and you're waiting for someone, and the plane's late. What are you doing? You're texting.
Okay. People watching.
Watching other people.
Oh, really?
Another career. But for social workers, not only are you watching, you're trying to figure it out, you're assessing. And you're starting to craft the narrative of people's lives. Are those her kids or his kids? You know, is he the custodial parent? You know, where are they? You know, the grandparents? Well, he looks a lot older than she does. So you're starting to. And I think that's fabulous. I said, don't ever lose that curiosity about people. Right? But the trick then becomes shifting the gaze from looking at the other, because that's what social workers do every single day, is that we're often objectifying other, you know, the gaze of the other, and put a mirror in front of them and say, who are you? And when is it your own breath blowing back in your face? And what does this mean for you to be doing this kind of work? So the inquirer is also the inquired into. You know, what is it that I'm thinking about in my practice? Where is the space for me to even do this piece of reflectivity? Because like teachers, social workers are mostly just trying to put one foot in front of the next every single day of their practice lives and just survive. So this whole notion of developing a reflective practitioner, you know, when I say that to students, they go, seriously? Like, you want me to do this? So So one of the dilemmas that I faced is that this capstone course, which I have poured my heart and soul into, the best thing I've ever done in my career, and I'm almost ready now to be dead or retired. Once I find another champion in my school to carry it forward, and so far that hasn't happened, is that they take it when, at the same time that they're doing their advanced practicum, which is 450 hours of indentured servitude. So students don't get paid. We actually make them pay tuition to do this. And they're trying to survive in this practice environment, trying to weave between an individual learner as well as an organizational learner. And then I swoop in and say, oh, and every single week you're going to have to post several times around things that I think are important, that the readings that I think you're going to do, and play with each other because they have to do this peer-to-peer learning. So they mostly wind up being half-dead. And so the superimposing the capstone onto an organizational learning framework is a critical tension that I still don't quite know what to do with. Keep your eyes on the prize, keep your eyes on the prize. The best MSW is a dumb MSW, and this gets you out the back door, and they usually believe me and stay there. So inquiry, reflection, in as much as, yes, I know there's no time, but you need to know that unless you're going to be hyper-conscious, you're never going to be able to be intentional in your practice. And so that's the other word that I really hang on to a lot of my students, is that even in a complicated environment where you feel like your hands are tied and you can't be very curious or very creative, you can still be intentional. You can still talk about why you've done what you've done in a particular intervention. And then the last word that I try and use in the capstone is this whole notion of integration, making connections between concepts, linking learning, applying, and transferring learning across the domains. And one of the best things about the electronic portfolio assignment in the capstone course is it allows the students to figure out who they are as a profession, what the most significant aha moments have been in their own personal lives as well as their professional journeys. So there's prompts in the capstone course for them to think about an assignment. We have a course called Knowledge and Inquiry. Right? So what did you think about in that course? Take the paper and put it into your EP. But there's also a place and space when, you know, what's your hobby or what's another personal accomplishment that really has shaped who you are as a person, and put that in there as well. The thing that I wasn't prepared for in the electronic portfolio is the aesthetic, the pure beauty of the way people brought images, pictures, their family experiences, special places in the world that they've been, the trips that they've taken, to really give themselves a chance to say, huh, look at where I've been, what I've done. And so they're really poetic. They, in fact, have written poetry, they've written stories, they've drawn. I have one student who even created a cartoon that she embedded within her electronic portfolio to talk about how she's making sense of this whole thing called social work. So what I'm trying to do in the capstone course as part of this professional learning journey is help the students see what it's like to create a narrative of growth for their own ongoing development. I sell the EP to say, yeah, it can be a digital resume, a digital CV, but really it's the story of your life. Therefore, one of the things that you're told that you're supposed to be able to do in an electronic portfolio is get peer feedback. Your social work student has been an absolute non-starter. This is a deeply personal journey for them. Yes, they're talking about their professional growth and development and who they are as a professional, but it's also something that they really don't want to share. They'll share it with me because they have to, but I bet if they didn't, they would take, as far as I know, they might still take huge pieces out of the electronic portfolio before they actually open it to me. So this whole notion of critically reflective practice and using the capstone gives them a chance to think about some questions like, what are the values and assumptions that guide my practice? What is my practice vision and worldview? You know, what do I think about social work? You know, here I've worked really hard to get an MSW and become a professional social worker. Do I still want to be one? How do my ways of knowing fit with the theories and interventions that I've been taught? I'm really curious in that one, you know, as professional social work practice mean? Should I be a regulated professional? Shouldn't I? Who are these people anyway? And what's my place going to be in professional social work? And how do I evaluate what is known, what is unknown, and how do I assess valid evidence? You know, what is the evidence that's guiding child protection social work? What is the evidence of guiding forensic social work? What is there any evidence, right? And what kind of cultural biases and Eurocentric and westernized views have informed that evidence? How do I deal with not knowing, uncertainty, and ambiguity? When is not knowing okay? What resources do I need for my ongoing professional development? And this is where I think development really hits the road. Because it's, if you create, going across the convocation stage, a curious and critical, self-reflective learner, what happens in the real world of practice to completely and totally, immediately extinguish that? The people who ask the hard questions are not necessarily the ones that are going to get the permanent positions, that are going to get the promotions, that are going to get the nod to people, yeah, you're our guy. So what are the tensions in professional practice environments? And how do we as educators start to influence those kinds of environments so that we're not sending our students out with very tiny swords to tilt your very tall dragons? And that's where I think we need to go next.
My name is John Fagan, as Kathy said. I've been here at UVic for 8 years now. I work as a career educator, is my role in the Faculty of Engineering. Work with undergrads as well as graduate students. And we have some subtle differences, I think, around professional learning, particularly for undergrads in engineering versus graduate students. Being an accredited program, so I was sitting here listening to the presentation going, oh, all of these commonalities and finding them as we went along. Historically, the way we worked towards professional practice was in engineering at UVic, we also have a mandatory co-op program. So the students have to have 16 months of work experience in order to graduate, or they have to go and find that work experience before they'll get their degree. That work experience does have to be directly related to their stream of study, whether it's civil, mechanical, or electrical engineering. And unlike the social workers and many education practicums, these are very well-paid co-ops. Sometimes, you know, I had a student recently got a $7,000 re-signing bonus to go back to Microsoft for another summer. So that we're going to be talking some pretty good money. A real shift recently, and I say recently, 2010 in engineering education, was getting away from using a logbook to keep track of these experiences and rather using a competency-based or a knowledge, skills, and attributes approach. So Engineers Canada and the accreditation boards for Canadian engineering education put out what we called their 12 graduate attributes. And we all did a bit of a double take when we had a look at these, because of these 12 graduate attributes, five of them are quite technically oriented, but the other seven are very, very socially oriented. So, you know, things like lifelong learning, communication, collaboration, ethics and equity, these sort of things. So, subsequently, accreditation of engineering programs since this change have caused some real challenges, because we don't have explicit courses teaching these things. These things are integrated into pieces of design courses for third and fourth year students. So there's a lot of the what they commonly refer to in engineering as professional skills are learned as a secondary piece of the education in a design course, collaborating with four other students to build a model of a bridge that has software that operates it and that sort of thing. But there's not a lot of intentional sitting down looking at the structure of how that communication works and how groups form and that sort of thing. So it's been quite interesting seeing the students going out onto the workplace and then coming back onto campus and actually asking for more communication skills and looking for this demand. So feeling almost in the last few years as though the professional experience is driving what the education is starting to look at implementing. the other piece of this is when students graduate, so also an accreditation body, APEG BC, the Association of Professional Engineers and Geoscientists, they work a little differently, so we don't have the exam, like the American engineering approach is to have an exam to become a professional engineer, very similar to what we heard about for social workers. In Canada, we have what we call an EIT, an engineering training, and students required, when they graduate, to spend 4 years as an EIT, learning under the guidance of a professional engineer before they're allowed to apply to become a professional engineer themselves. So 4 years of a degree and then 4 years as an engineer training. We're finding that it's making quite a difference in the students are from UVic with our mandatory co-op program going out there with 16 months of experience already, whereas a lot of students coming from programs where co-op is not mandatory are just getting through their academics and then having to spend these 4 years. So there's some advantage, I think, to students having the experience while they're doing their 4 years of academics to gain some work experience and take out with them so that they end up, they actually get for senior level co-ops, so third and fourth year co-ops, they can count that time as EIT time or professional learning time. It's also interesting to watch the shift in engineering as a profession, because there's really quite a change, as we've seen in the last 10 years or 8 years since 2008 and a lot of the global financial shifts. Just like stock markets, labor markets have shifted and changed and become a lot more volatile. So the data is saying that a baby boomer generation would have had 5 to 7 career jobs in their life, and an engineer, Gen Y or a millennial is going to have 12 to 15 different career jobs in their life. So this brings in the other piece of my own experience. So I thought I'd dive into the engineering and where I'm coming from. I studied mechanical engineering 30 years ago in South Africa, and I used to build sugar factories in Southern Africa. I've worked in the oil patch up in Alberta in manufacturing. I've worked as a mental health and addictions counselor up in Haida Gwaii. I came to Canada, and my degree, which was a 3-year degree from South Africa, was invalid. So instead of doing that, I thought I'd try something else. I studied engineering because my dad was an engineer and my granddad was an engineer. So I did a philosophy degree here at UVic with a minor in psychology, and did a thesis on philosophical counseling, so looking at helping people with their problems in life from the point of view of how it makes meaning to their life. And I think what this has brought me to, and I feel really grateful working in engineering where I can apply my technical interest and expertise as well as my care around the human condition and helping people improve their life. But I think what I'm seeing more and more is this need for a shift away from thinking of learning as a product or a thing that we can take and put into a container, to a perspective on learning where it's participation, it's emergent, it's part of becoming who you are and developing as a human being to then go and apply out in one's professional life. I thought, as far as this question of what is professional learning in a program, in our programs in engineering, we were discussing earlier, more and more graduate programs that are quite specialized into certain areas. A really recent one is the Masters in Cybersecurity, which is a field that has a really high demand for graduates. And it's quite interesting trying to get these folks who have been undergrads in electrical engineering, computer science, and who are typically quite linear thinkers, to try and think outside the box and think the way a hacker might think. And watching these folks challenged with that, and so we have a capstone project course where we're working with these particular students on putting together a simulated banking interaction, like we all do our banking online, and then having a team of these students try and hack that interaction. Watching the students not catch what their colleagues are thinking is quite interesting. So, you know, I think they sort of feel like they need to kick themselves going, how come I didn't see that? Because I would have thought the same thing. But I think this idea of having to broaden one's perspective, having to think of things like change management, things like complexity management, and understanding that, you know, what we all understand is 21st century learning and the unique issues that come with that are impacting all different aspects of learning, so learning in the workplace and in different professions. But I think if we can sit together and look at these problems as common problems, we could learn in engineering from social work and from education and find ways that perhaps in education you're already addressing these problems that in engineering we haven't even thought of yet. So yeah, I think I'll leave it at that so we can get on with the discussion.
So, comments, questions, resonances, differences?
I just want to say a couple of things. First of all, this has been great because one of the things we're working on is trying to shift in the K-12 sector in response to the changing world outside. So sitting here and listening to everybody dealing with the same issues is great and affirming. But something you said, Pat, that I've been thinking lots about, we all have those same obstacles. And what is it that we're going to be able to, we have to really push it in order for it to happen, or we are going to have those kids coming out trained and skilled in the competency side, running into the, you need to know this. This is what we're used to. Somebody actually said to me, I still haven't recovered from this comment, was a teacher. Said, really, should we be giving them all this inquiry, competencies, when really they're going to run into that world that doesn't have any? In other words, shouldn't we just give them a miserable experience so that they're prepared for the miserable experience, right? And then someone else said, this is going to be a generational change. So once I stopped weeping in the corner over thinking about that, because we've got exponential change going on over here in the real world, and I'm really worried about we're going to take so much time to shift our culture that we're going to render ourselves irrelevant, right? And there's places around the world that are grabbing this. So I'm just curious as to your thoughts around, okay, we all have the same issue. What are we going to do? We have to do something collectively and wholeheartedly, I think, to really stop tinkering around the edges.
So we're really looking for the answer, right?
Yes, today, before I go home. Or your thoughts on, you know, you've done the things in your areas of learning. What's a bigger, broader kind of thing we can start with?
Yeah, well, I mean, Tim and Kathy know my frustrations of, you know, trying to approach my relationship with the learners who, I mean, this is my practice box. These are the people that I'm purporting to serve. So approaching them in such a way that, you know, unless the curriculum makes sense to them and allows them to think sideways as well as front back, we're doing them a disservice. But we just had this big meeting to talk about the capstone course and the evaluation criteria. And I said, well, first of all, we're not evaluating the capstone. We're assessing it. Right? We're not judging it. So I think that's the first thing that we need to do is give ourselves a really serious shake around what are we doing in university environments that why would I, on earth, I mean, I know I've been a social worker for 41 years. I have some thoughts about it. But put two social workers in a room and you get three opinions, right? So why would I be the person who can judge this? What I need to know is how can I till the soil so whatever seeds the students have to plant will grow for them? I don't care if they plant carrots and tomatoes and they don't do companion planting according to the rules. It's their garden. So how can we just tend the gardens and how can we build those kinds of gardens that are like community gardens? So the first thing we need to do is get rid of our silos. I have found moral friends outside of my faculty where, frankly, oh God, I wish this wasn't being taped. Well, frankly, I feel like I'm surrounded by moral strangers, right? You know, within my own discipline, it's like, what language are you talking? Because I can't hear you and they can't hear me. So, and I think that is what's happening in professional practice. In education, in social work, I won't speak for Lynn in nursing. I mean, I education perspective is, but we need to find places to cross bridges. And I think our students, and I think particularly young students, are forcing us to do that. They want to think sideways. They actually don't want to think like this. They want to think like this. So I don't know what's happened to education as far as turning students into becoming functionaries and competent in these particular pathways. And I've heard that, you know, students in grade 8 are supposed to choose their particular pathway.
Myth.
Right?
A myth in this program.
Great. But what's happened to music programs? You know, and art and recreation and all those sorts of things where, you know, everybody has their own ideas about what is a really important thing to learn. But how do we make place and spaces that there's enough elasticity? But if we don't model it, you know, within a university environment, I think it's really unrealistic to expect to see it in professional practice. So down with the silos. Students. So there are various definitions of what capstone is. So yes, a part of it is the culminating educational experience. You know, what sense of it have they made of the curriculum? So in many ways it can be a piece of program evaluation. Right? Is the curriculum making sense? Because do the students reflect it? But the other part is the students that are coming to our graduate programs bring with them often decades of what I would call unexamined data, which is their own practice life and their own personal life. So they have resumes that are pages thick because they've done all kinds of really interesting different kinds of social work. And they can talk about what they did, but they haven't had a chance to say what it meant and how that experience doing that particular kind of social work in that environment convinced them that they're never going to be in that situation again. Or in fact, it provided them a foundation to scaffold their learning. So, and I think this is the dilemma that I'm having in my own school, talking about the value of the capstone course, because people think it should be a culminating thing, and they should then be able to prove that they've learned from the curriculum and can give things back to us. So that's, we'll evaluate that. I'm not really interested in that, because I don't think it's useful for the students, and I also think it's my place, I think it's perfect. What I'm more interested in is providing some kind of a way for them to say, okay, what have I been doing? And why have I been doing that? And why have I been doing it that way? And how can I be curious about that practice? And how can I then either own it and say, yes, that is my practice framework, or reject it and replace it with something else? So I want the students to feel uncomfortable and unsettled, because that's the only way that they're going to be. So there are so few places in social work practice to really criticize your own, you're not going to point out your own mistakes, and it'll last very long, but to be critical of the way you've done things. That I want the capstone course to be about that, and my colleagues don't. So the biggest struggle for my colleagues with the capstone course is that they can't figure out where they fit in the course. And I'm going, exactly. Right? Exactly. Right. We should be invisible.
Right. Mm-hmm. There must be a real tension between that, the goals of the capstone versus the goals of the standardized assessment that's working towards accreditation. There's not much overlap.
Well, it's not accreditation. And so the exams are the regulatory body.
Sorry, certification. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, certification and regulation. So they want to prove that you learned the right stuff in your social work program. And as far as I know, there aren't any questions that are derived from the code.
Well, and I'd just like to follow up the idea that the engineers, before they can apply to become a professional engineer, need to do 4 years of working with a professional engineer. Which is kind of, you know, Or do they, I mean, one of the things we've been trying in our program, just as an aside, is for the teacher candidates to gather evidence of their own progress towards program goals, which then means they have to gather evidence. So I'm curious about this piece and ways in which maybe those could be built in both into all professional programs, is that there's this sort of learning that goes on within the program and then there's the piece afterwards. So
There is a requirement for reporting their learning through the EIT.
Mm-hmm.
It was interesting though when I had a look to double check before I came today,
mm-hmm.
that as a professional engineer, as a PEng, it's not a requirement that they undertake professional development, it's strongly encouraged,
mm-hmm.
which is quite interesting given the way technology is changing.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I'm registered as a certified career development professional with the BC Career Development Association,
mm-hmm.
and the requirements I have to recertify with that every 5 years are more stringent than the engineers have to face,
mm-hmm.
and I don't know that that's a good thing.
Mm-hmm.
When you look at technology changing the way it is, you would think that they would be a lot stricter on accrediting an engineer as a PM.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it comes from the breadth of different topics within engineering.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, even in biomedical engineering, there's dozens of different areas from computer work to, working with prosthetics and that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's really hard to define when there's so many different approaches.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I was interested in something actually that you alluded to, Pat, and I'd like to invite both of you to talk about it because it's something I've always wondered about in the context of teacher ed. So what sorts of, Gary used the word structures or places do you have within your programs when the learning in your professional program has led a student in your program to realize that this profession is perhaps not for them? And, what sorts of, I'm just curious about how you work with your students on along those lines, because, I certainly remember my own crisis of confidence when I went through my initial teacher ed, and, I still think it was the right career for me at the time, but the difference between a crisis of confidence versus I don't think this is for me, and I'm not talking about people who aren't meeting program goals or program outcomes or are doing very poorly on practicum, but just people who are starting to question, like, how do you deal with those kinds of things in your programs? I'm curious.
Well, practicum is the proof of the pudding. For our MSW program, we have two pathways. So the two-year program is for people who don't have a previous social work degree.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, we're relatively new at that, and we get hundreds of applications, so there's about a 1 in 9 chance of getting in. And so those people have had other graduate degrees. Some of them are teachers, some of them are nurses. I don't think we've had any engineers yet, but we have an oceanographer. And so the goal of the first year is to tell them what social work is, or at least our view of that, because for all of us, it's been a long time since we had a real job. So what is social work and how do you need basic understandings of the profession? And then they do a foundation practicum. And you can have students who can whip through the taught courses, the highly theoretical things, A+, and they get into the first practice environment to ostensibly learn from the best teachers in the books, and they fall flat in their face. Either they can't walk the walk, or they realize, I didn't know I was going to have to do that. And so they kind of self-select out, rarely. More often, we're in that really uncomfortable place where you've got the field educator. These are what I call the unsung heroes and heroines of social work education who are doing this for free. We give them really cheesy chocolate bars and bags of dried mango as a thank you present. That's what I was gifted. No, I went to the liquor store and I bought a whole bunch of wine. These are important relationships to me. But you get someone who actually cannot be a social worker. They can't actually do it. They can't manage the classroom. They can't manage the practice. And so then it's the poor field educator who's doing this for free who has to pull the plug. And that really sucks. So that happens. But the other thing about social work is that it's really a very versatile career. And there are
service tech.
Sectors, you know, you might not be very good working with young children, but you really resonate to working in seniors care, or forensic works for you, but not child protection. So it doesn't happen that often. We do certainly on occasion say, you're dangerous, you've got some really, you know, fill in the blank attitudes, Mckenzie, when you shift, we need to redirect you into engineering at the faculty. In the old days in hospital social work, we called that buffing and turfing. You don't want them on your board, so you do whatever you can to punt them somewhere else.
I think in engineering at UVic for the Bachelor of Engineering program, the first year is common for all different disciplines. So they do predominantly sciences. There is, however, there are two courses. One is a design-based course where they collaborate in groups to do design projects. The other is called Introduction to Professional Practice, and it's partly a work readiness course, getting them prepared for their co-ops a year later. But it's also a bit of a contextualizing for them of how this fits in and how all the science they're doing. But that's where the biggest attrition rate is in first year, when they're end of their first year realizing this applied science is not my real interest, and 25 to 30%, so really high attrition rate at that point. And in the last 4 years, in order to try and address this, we created a third year course, Engineering 330, which is professional career planning and engineering leadership. And it was an optional elective. It's not a mandatory course like that first year course is. And these students doing this actually also, part of this course was an embedded mentorship program where the senior students, third and fourth year students, mentored two or three younger students in first year to try and reduce that attrition rate that we had in first year. And we found that it certainly is making a difference. Students who weren't certain what was going on in first year could speak to their third or fourth year mentor.
Did you do any exploration about precursors of antecedents for higher attrition amongst those people?
We haven't gone into that much detail. This has been
just waiting for you, Todd.
Yeah, no. I don't think that'll help.
So a question that came up, our group was put out a panel group, and it's come up with both of you, and in relation to professional programs as compared to the humanities, social sciences, liberal arts, we seem to have adopted a grading system that's based on a set of knowledge. And in our discussion, it wasn't get rid of that, but more the articulation of what grading system should we be using for what purposes in our professional program. And surely we should have a rationale that leads towards, you're not doing it for a grade, you're doing it for an experience, which leads towards the capstone and the type of lecturing portfolio where I am articulating myself. But I'm trying to imagine in a professional program what that grading assessing system would look like, based on the experiences that professional program is offering. Have you got any ideas of how that might look or what it is looking like in your programs?
Yeah, it's the biggest dilemma. So the capstone course sort of came out of my head, and I taught it one term as a pilot, and then it went on sabbatical and gifted it to one of my colleagues. And when I left, it was graded 0 to 100. When I came back, it was complete incomplete, much to my surprise. I must have missed that memo because I didn't realize it until the next time I taught it, and I went into my grades on fast, and I'd been sweating bullets. Who gets a 78? Who gets the 81? Who gets the 87? I went to enter on fast, and the only option was complete incomplete. I'm going, are you kidding me? I just spent all this time sort of slicing and dicing. So the conversation was around evaluation versus assessment, judging, what am I measuring, you know, there's no place for me in this. So the default position of my colleagues was just they either did it or they didn't. Okay, so it's complete, incomplete. That is not me. But now there actually is a 0 to 100. So I was showing Jan just before we broke, I've got this little rubric that I found, and it's unsatisfied, and there's all these things that they have to do in capstone as far as choosing the artifact, you know, unsatisfactory, emerging, proficient, exemplary. So if you think about as a professional learner, are you unsatisfactory because you're not, like, at least a bit curious about this, you know, are you becoming, is it emerging, you're just starting to say, oh yeah, I get it. Are you proficient or are you exemplary? And it's much the same way that we would give a reference for a student. I mean, I have to do this all the time. Like, are you kidding? Don't hire them under any circumstances for anything at any time. They might get there in the right kind of supportive environment and all those other kind of weasel words that we use for those references that we're not quite sure about. To, yeah, they'll get the basics done. You know, they've got the proficiency. They'll be a steady eddy to, this person's going to be a leader in your operation. So that's how I'm thinking about this right now. But the other part of this picture is they're not widgets. You know, these are people. And our students who are coming from the foundation year until they hit our place probably never met a social worker. They just thought, oh, these MSW degrees are kind of handy. Because they unlock all kinds of really cool doors. They're good degrees. So I'm going to get you one of those. But they don't have this decades of social work experience like our advanced year students do who have got a BSW and they've been slugging it out and they're the supervisor of the child protection unit or the hospital. So they're coming from different places. So I start where they're at and I'm helping them measure where they're going to get to. And so because they're all starting at different places, it's shifting sands. They're not widgets.
I find it quite interesting in engineering, Tim, because at the undergrad level, what we had was this course Engineering 130, which was a complete incomplete, and we changed it to a graded course because the students weren't taking it seriously because they didn't get a grade for it. Whereas at the graduate level, what we're seeing is more integration of complete incomplete as well as graded. So a course, for example, in the cybersecurity program, 20% of it is reflective questions that the students have to answer weekly. And how do you grade a reflection? You complete that part and you incomplete it. So as long as they write a paragraph or more, they get the grade for that piece. But at least it's getting them to look reflectively at what they're learning and how they're learning.
Looking at the time, and thank you, both of you, for a really rich contribution to our thinking. So thank you. One of the things this helps us remember is that we have a lot of commonalities across professional programs. I'm sure you have colleagues everywhere that are working in other professional programs. It might be nice to get together with them and think through some of these big issues together. We have a lot in education to contribute, but we can also listen to some of the dilemmas that other professions have and think about what their responses are to some of these big questions. So thank you very much for sharing your insights with us. We're going to take 10 minutes now, and then Lisa's going to tell you what we're going to do next.
So we had some great conversations this morning, and of course this. Oh, thank you very much. So we had some great conversations this morning, and of course this prompts our thinking, and there's lots of thinking, and then we scheduled another breakout session, and then said we'll self-select the groups, and then it occurred to me this morning that that's actually a much more complicated task than I initially thought when it looked really nice on paper. And so I thought what we would do is we would flip the session. So after the break that we'll take, we'll have our larger plenary next, and we're going to do our mind mapping activity where we can generate some ideas. We're going to do it very visually. We're going to put some stuff up on the wall. And then that will then kind of allow us to kind of create some themes and do our self-selection kind of through some of what we've discussed and the ideas we've brought forth. Then after that big group session, then we'll do one last breakout.